What a beautiful melody in this piano. Wonderful. And what a way to start our day fellowshipping together. I rejoiced with those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Good morning.
Good morning.
And of course, we welcome all of us to the house of the Lord. This is the time that we take and that we separate to praise and worship the Lord and also listen to His word. And it's a beautiful day, just like last Sunday. I think it was probably it seemed like it was going to rain. But that doesn't matter, because it's another day of joy and of mercies that our Lord allows us to live. Thank you so much, Lord. Thank you. So we gather as the family of God, and we are welcoming our announcements. I'm not sure if anyone here has an announcement.
Soup to Go is this week on Wednesday.
Amen to that. I will be here getting my soup. I also wanted to make a little short prayer for our sister Cindy, who's going to go out and bring a sermon to, as a lay leader that she is, out into another church. And it's always good to pray for each other when we have our different tasks to do. So we will take a little minute to pray for our sister. So at this moment, at this time, we are bringing in the light of Christ.
Lord, with me.
the prayer of the people that's printed in your bulletin. Let us pray. Lord, we would follow you wherever you might lead.
Lord, we would follow you.
Forgive us when we stumble and when we stray.
Forgive us when distracted we lose our way.
Be the one to whom we turn, whose hand we hold.
The shepherd who leads us, the faithful to the fold.
Lord, we would follow you wherever you might lead.
Lord, we follow you.
So you've noticed in your bulletin you've got an insert. Just toward the end, we're going to have you sing with us. And you'll easily find the tune, if not hard. We welcome your voices, and I'll cut you off when you're supposed to stop.
Pray together, growing together.
enjoyed that. That was very beautiful, because that is exactly what we are, a family.
Love you.
We're the family of Christ. And as such, we love each other, as families do. Amen to that.
Amen.
We will now enter into our sermon. I will be reading 1 Timothy. I'm sorry. We will read 1 Timothy, chapter 1, verses 12 through 17. And I will be reading the New International Version. First Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 13 says, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service, even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man. I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But that very reason I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, with honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen to that. Before I start, I will make a prayer, and I also want to pray for our sister Cindy. I think it's just a privilege and an honor that you can bring a word, a sermon, to a church or to any setting that needs that sermon. Father, we thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Give us all hearts and an ear open to your guiding spirit, in Jesus' name. We also pray for our sister Cindy, who is out in another congregation. We pray that you put a word in her that comes from you, Lord, and that the word that you are sending out today, as your word says, becomes that double-edged sword and does the work that you want to do in the hearts of everyone, every listener, and every visitor. Bless her, and that your grace be over her, Lord. In your name, Jesus, amen.
Amen.
As I read this passage, I was drawn to something that I seek every day, and that is gratitude, whether my days and situations are manageable or not. And we all can attest to that. That we do have some days where, you know, it's just not our day. And there's situations too that are situations that fall out of our control. Whether my emotions betray me and I'm not trusting the Lord, we have those situations on those days. It is gratifying to hear the Apostle Paul describe the mercies he received throughout his journey, starting with the first personal encounter with God. And you all know that at some point, God had to intervene in Saul of Tarsus before he became Paul the Apostle, had to intervene and kind of like bring him into a new light and understanding of what he was doing, which was very wrong. To acknowledge all of the grace and favor Paul received was just an adulation and praise to Jesus Christ. I can recall the many times that I have received mercy. I can recall many times thinking I really do not deserve all this love and care. And it's just our human side, because we know, you know, sometimes we know who we are, and we don't always do the right thing, or we don't always walk in that path of holiness that, you know, God expects. And not to say that God expects us to be perfect, because we're human beings and we are imperfect. So then again, that is what God's grace is about, Romans 5:20, in regards to grace, but the law came to increase and expand the awareness of the trespass by defining and unmasking sin. But where sin increased, God's remarkable gracious gift of grace, his unmerited favor, has surpassed it and increased all the more. This is the Amplified Bible version of Romans 5:20, because it just explains it in detail of what God's grace is. Can you recall the moments of grace over your life? Maybe we can recall those moments. Perhaps we can make memory of those instances, just as Paul recalled each one of those moments of grace received. What does grace mean? The Merriam-Webster Dictionary says unmerited divine assistance given to humans for their regeneration or sanctification, a virtue coming from God. That is very powerful. In this pastoral epistle that Paul writes to Timothy, the young pastor, he starts with a greeting and then warnings of false teachings. He gives Timothy instructions of not wasting time in meaningless discussions, but to give attention and priority to having a pure heart filled with love. Paul then proceeds to take a trip down memory lane and mention how thankful and grateful he is that God chose him to do ministry, although in the past he had been a blasphemer, a persecutor of Christians, shameful, outrageous, and a violent man. Can you imagine a Christian person or someone who believes in God behaving in such a way and having that type of lifestyle? Clearly, only the grace of God transformed his life as he became a better version of himself. Paul shares in this chapter that Jesus Christ granted him the strength and made him able. Paul understood the fundamental truth of who God is. 1 John 4:8 says, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Knowing that God is love, the fruits of the Spirit, which we have mentioned in the past weeks, found in Galatians 5:22, are an echo to the love of God toward you and I. In that same love, he is patient, kind, and long-suffering with us. Those are moments of grace. Paul also wrote in Ephesians 5:8, for you were once darkness, but now you are light in the world. Live as children of light. This is the reflection that Paul was intending when he spoke of what the grace of God does in its different contexts. When I state context, I speak of the Wesleyan concept of grace, the prevenient grace, the justifying grace, and the sanctifying grace. These are the graces that our own denomination and we as Methodists practice, and we also teach that we all go through these stages of grace where God is at the beginning of our journey when we didn't know him, but he gracefully led us to him. And after that, that's the prevenient grace. The justifying is when we start to believe and start to work and start to walk with the Lord and allowing the transformations to happen in our lives. The apostle Paul is a great example of God's grace. He was one of the leaders of the first generation of Christians, the apostle of the Gentiles, the man who influenced Christian theology. We can certainly understand why Paul is sharing with the young pastor Timothy his own profound experiences. And this is how we testify to others. Modeling Christ is about our own lifestyles and what we teach others when it comes to a Christian life and a life that is pleasing to Christ. Paul believed that he was an example in leading others to Jesus, that if God thought he was worthy of giving grace to. Let me repeat that. Paul believed that he was an example in leading others to Jesus Christ, that if God thought he was worthy of giving grace to all those who desire to know God can obtain the grace that Christ offers. There are many stories in the Bible of men and women who were called by God to fulfill a plan. God's plan always includes transformation to carry out and complete his purpose. And I'm pretty sure that we can all relate to transformation and also walking in God's purpose. And it doesn't matter what it is that God has called you to do, but he has called us all to walk in a purpose that he has for each of us. The liberator of the Israelites, Moses, assassinated an Egyptian man and buried him. God made a way for Moses to experience knowing him intimately. Moses became a pastor of sheep for 40 years. Talk about process and journeys. He also experienced God revealing himself through a burning bush. All of these seasons in Moses' life were in preparation to the task that lay ahead of him. In comparison with Paul's story, before we are born, God has a plan for each one of us. God knew that Saul of Tarsus, the Pharisee, would be the person he became, a religious follower of the law. God in his grace intervened in both of these men's lives to carry out his plan. I would like to mention at least one woman from the Bible, Rahab. To give a short account, she was the life the Israelites spared when they conquered Jericho. Rahab was a harlot or a prostitute that God used to assist the Israelites in conquering the city. She hid the two men who were spying until they were able to safely leave to report to Joshua. This story is found in the book of Joshua, chapter 2. She received grace from God in such a powerful way. Although she was a harlot and led a life that back then and now we consider sinful and shameful, God does not see what we are, but who we will become once transformation takes its course. Rahab became the mother of Boaz, and if you can remember, he became Ruth's husband. And this is from the story of Ruth and Naomi. And further down in this lineage, Jesus comes into the picture. And I just think that, I think and feel that it's, you know, God is marvelous because he doesn't pick someone, you know, and he doesn't choose people that are just good and have nothing, as we Hispanic people would say, skeletons in the closet. And he came for the sinner. He came for those that really, really need him. So Rahab, as I mentioned before, became the mother of Boaz. If you can remember, he became Ruth's husband, and further down in this lineage, Jesus came into the picture. So Jesus is coming from all these backgrounds and people who had a story to tell, and from being liberated and freed from a lifestyle that was a sinful lifestyle. Those are examples of the unmerited grace that we receive from Jesus Christ. And I praise and I say hallelujah to God for his grace and his love. I want to share a short little poem that is very deep. And this poem was written by Sri Chinmoy. Yesterday I lived inside my mind's disastrous uncertainty like the sea. Today I am living inside my heart's rapturous divinity like the ocean. This is what my Lord's unconditional grace has done for me. To conclude, I want to share one of my many experiences of God's grace in my life. Several years ago, I had an unexpected diagnosis. It was not a life or death situation. However, I was very bothered and frustrated. I had already set, the frustration was already set in me. And I was looking for solutions, and I saw nothing that would alleviate my troubled heart. I had a conversation with this particular person about my diagnosis and how angry I felt that I was not diagnosed before. The person responded and said to me, Merici, Why are you upset and angry? Has not God been walking with you during the hard times? And although you've been diagnosed, it shows that God's mercy has brought you through. And you learned to cope, and you have the ability and the capacity, although you had those issues or you had that diagnosis. I had to step back to say, you know, honestly, and accept that I had not recognized God's mercy in my life, and I was too focused on my frustration and was blinded by my emotions. Yes, I asked God to forgive me and my ignorance and my anger. I was able to acknowledge that God was truly working in my life, and I was being tested also, because God will test us to see where our faith, you know, is our faith strong? Are we believing in Him? Are we believing in miracles and things that He can do in our lives? That is why He is our God, and this is why we serve Him, because we rely on Him. I ask you today, are you able to remember and number the mercies and grace we have received, no matter what we have done and who we were or who we are? During this week coming up, as we devote time and prayer with God, allow yourself to bring to your mind and heart all the favor that God has bestowed upon you and also myself. Let us bow our heads to pray. Heavenly Father and God of all creation, do not allow us to take for granted your grace and your love. We pray that you help us to have a heart of gratitude and thanksgiving in all of our circumstances. We need you, Lord, because without you, we are nothing. Align our hearts and minds to yours, and that we may hear your voice in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
That is the word of the Lord.
Thanks.
We will now, and if you could join me, please, in the hymn Amazing Grace, number 378.
I'm
got lost in probably the first verse, but thank the Lord for all of you. So we may be seated. We respond to the heart of God with giving our offerings. And as usual, our plate is in the back. We will sing our doxology, page 94.
And it was really bothering my heart. It really was. We've always had a tumultuous relationship growing up. But he had recently, in the last 7 years, started speaking to me and treating me like a sister instead of a stranger. And recently we fell out over something that was not in my control, but he saw it as disrespect, so he hadn't talked to me in a while. My brother's a handyman. So on Monday night, I received a text at 11 o'clock at night from my brother. And it said, I understand you have electricity problems. I'm on my way over. Nice. And so he came over, he spent 2 hours in my house, could not find the problem. So now I'm worried that I'm gonna have to hire an electrician. As everybody knows, it's hundreds and thousands of dollars sometimes, especially if you need to have which is what I thought I needed, was my electrical panel rebuilt. So my brother said, call National Grid and see what they tell you. Well, I called them. They went through my whole entire house and they said, nothing's wrong in the house. It's a breaker at your meter. And luckily for you, that's your landlord's responsibility. So on top of everything else, I got my brother back. It did not cost me a dime to have this fixed. My landlord was right on top of it. The next day, everything was fixed. My electricity was back on. And I do thank God for that. It was a mercy that he showed us. I take to Facebook sometimes. I have a lot of prayer warriors on my Facebook. And that Saturday night, I took to Facebook and I put down what it was. And I said, you know, I need this specific prayer. And, you know, within 4 days, God responded. And I just wanted to share that with you guys because that was, you know, not only a burden financially that was going to be on me, but also my blood pressure went sky high because I didn't know what I was going to do. And, well, that took care of all that, and I thank God for that.
Nice.
Those sibling rivalries, right? Yes.
I took another tumble this week.
Oh, no.
And I was pushing down my recycling. I have a regular, like a trash can. I need to go out to the mailbox, so I said, I'll take this down with me. Well, I don't know what happened. I had a pair of shoes on that I wear around the house all the time, and the backs are out of them, but I've worn them outside many times. But all of a sudden, down I in the can went. And I was in the middle of my driveway. First time I've fallen on a hard surface. But anyhow, I have a joy that I didn't break any bones.
Amen to that.
I got a few sore spots, but I'm all right. But what I really, really want to say is two men, the cars kept going by and the trucks, and I thought, oh, Lord. And I had my phone, and I went to call, I was just ready to call my son. All of a sudden, these two trucks pull in my yard. And the one guy came up to me and he said, are you all right? And I said, yes. But I said, I can't get up. And I said, I'm just calling my son now. And so he said, the other guy stayed behind. I think they thought that I was going to be afraid of them or something because the other one said, are you okay? And or come up, or does she need help, or whatever. So up he came, and he said, we're here to help you. And he looked me, you know, right straight in the eyes. So they lifted me up, and they had seen me and turned around and said something wasn't right. They thought something wasn't right, so they came back to lift me up. I said, what a blessing. What a true blessing these men were.
God sends angels when we need them.
God sends angels when we need them. Yes, I said. Anyone else have a joy or a concern? Any prayers?
I baked a big dish of 20-ounce apples. They're out there, so stay and enjoy some. And I brought more 20-ounce apples today, so you know, make sure to take them all.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, wonderful. We will do that, Chris. Yes.
Just a celebration for, I'm very happy and proud of my husband. He's now a colonel.
Oh, nice.
He had a ceremony, which I may have even attended out in Pennsylvania, but he'll have another one in Rochester, I'm sure. He's worked very hard for his promotion. He's been trying to get promoted for a few years and kept getting rejected and didn't understand why.
God's timing is awesome, right?
Yes.
Anyone else would like to share?
Yes. I'm having some eye surgery on Tuesday.
I don't know the week.
Yes, during the week, let's keep our sister Lynn, right? And welcome back. It's Lynn, right?
Yes.
Yes, our sister Lynn, let's keep her in prayer. Also, I don't see Amy here, but we've also been praying for her husband, Greg, who I think also had surgery this past week. So yes, let's keep each other in prayer. Anyone else before we bow our heads for another prayer? Okay, let's bow our heads. We rejoice, Heavenly Father, with sharing among us happy events in our lives. You make known to us the path of life. You will fill us with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures. Thank you for the moments of love and peace. We pray over those that are experiencing illness. We pray strength, peace, and healing over our bodies. God, you are the great healer. We also thank you for the grace that you show us every day. Help us, Lord, to keep ourselves drawn near to you, Lord, and that our hearts every day show you, Lord, and demonstrate to you the gratitude that we have of that love and grace that you show us every single day in your mercy, Lord. In your name, Jesus, amen to that. Thank you for sharing. That was beautiful. If you want to stand on your feet, we're going to sing It's Me, O Lord, number 352.
Thank you. This is the bell. It is. This is the tolling striker. And when you swing the bell, there's a striker in the bell right there. It swings over and it must have to, maybe it doesn't strike on that side. Maybe one side has a spring. I don't know, I'm not gonna ring it because it's loud.